Hi, my name is Dr. Joseph Becker. I'm one of the emergency physicians at Stanford University School of Medicine.
And I'm Dr. Joseph Kalanzi, an emergency medicine resident at Makerere University College of Health Science in Uganda. In this talk, we're going to discuss the general approach to troubleshooting problems and alarms for patients on ventilators. We're going to talk about a systematic approach to examining patients and ventilators when problems are encountered.
So the objectives of this talk is to recognize commonly encountered problems that are experienced by patients on ventilators. We also would like to have you be able to manage and interpret ventilator alarms when they sound. And then last but not least, it'll be important to know how to prevent and troubleshoot common ventilator issues as they arise. Any decompensation in the clinical condition of the patient should prompt an immediate examination of both the patient as well as the ventilator system. The examination of the patient should prioritize the cardiopulmonary parts of the exam and as well the entire ventilator circuit. Taking a look at the ventilator from the wall, oxygen and power sources, and tracing these lines back through the ventilator itself and then following the ventilator tubing to the patient.
Check the ventilator tubing for occlusion or kinking. The endotracheal tube should be checked as well to assure that the balloon is inflated and that the tube is secured in place. It's always a good idea to document where the tube is located, such as 23 centimeters at the lips, to know if the tube may have been dislodged or moved.
First actions. If a problem is not readily identified in your survey, tracing the vent, power, and oxygen sources through the ventilator machine and then through the tubing to the patient, as well as the examination of the patient, then the next step should be to remove the patient from the ventilator and to provide manual bag valve breaths with direct 100% oxygen.
Removing the patient from the ventilator and providing manual breaths with a bag valve is a good way to exclude any potential mechanical problems with the vent or its power source, or if there is a problem with any of the ventilator tubing. As well, this will allow you to feel how easy it is to bag the patient and if there's adequate chest rise. A significant amount of resistance could indicate that there's an obstruction in the endotracheal tube, such as a mucus plug. Lack of resistance and chest rise could indicate that the endotracheal tube balloon is deflated or that there is a leak.
As with many things in medicine, it's important to be systematic. And there's a checklist for this called the DOPES checklist, as you see here. The DOPES checklist is used to identify problems patients commonly encounter while on the vent.
We'll also look at the DOTS checklist, which is a checklist of the interventions we undertake to address the problems we should have identified in the DOPES checklist.
So as you see, D stands for a displaced endotracheal tube or a deflated cuff. So these things should be checked on your examination. O stands for obstruction. Is there a mucus plug in the endotracheal tube or is the tubing kinked? P stands for pneumothorax. So examine the patient's chest and make sure you hear bilateral breath sounds. If there's any doubt, perform an ultrasound or obtain an x-ray. E is equipment malfunction. And like we said, you want to assess the ventilator as well as the associated tubing and its power supply and make sure everything is functioning appropriately. S stands for breath stacking, which we're going to talk about in a second here, but is a source of what we call PEEP or excessive pressure in the thorax, which can create problems as well. DOTS is the checklist we use to organize our approach after going through the DOPES checklist. DOTS helps us avoid forgetting important interventions in checking the vent system.
So DOTS stands for, D is disconnect the patient from the ventilator, or oxygenate the patient with a bag valve and feel for resistance to bagging. T stands for tube position, check for kinking, obstruction, etc. T is tweak the vent settings, and S, sonogram, look for pneumothorax or mainstem intubation. Ventilators come in a variety of brands and levels of complexity, and alarms can be set for pretty much any variable. This is a list of some of the more common ventilator alarms.
Keep in mind that it's important to set alarms appropriately. An alarm should trigger a response from you. If alarms are set poorly and a ventilator is always alarming, it will be less likely for clinical staff to actually respond to the alarm when it sounds. Thus, it'll be important to make sure alarms are set so that when they alarm, they will likely indicate there's a problem, and so you'll have to get up and address it.
Many ventilators will have some form of respiratory rate monitoring. Patients whose respiratory rate falls below a set value will trigger the alarm. Apneic patients who either have no respiratory drive or who have been sedated or paralyzed and thus have lost respiratory drive may trigger these alarms commonly unless the alarm is set appropriately. Some vents alarm at low tidal volume, which can reflect apnea.
Pressure alarms are very important to monitor in the vented patient. Secretions or water in the tubing or kinks in ventilator tubing can cause high pressure alarms. In this case, you'd want to suction the patient and look for other problems like tube kinking. If this does not fix the problem, disconnect the patient from the circuit and manually ventilate with a bag valve. Low pressure alarms are also important and can indicate that there is a leak in the system, such as a deflated endotracheal tube balloon or a disconnection in the tubing. Again, it's important to systematically follow the vent tubing from the machine to the patient to make sure that the lining is connected and that there are no leaks.
Alarms can also detect abnormalities or changes in expiratory volumes. Decreasing expiratory volumes indicate that there's a leak somewhere in the system, similar to low airway pressure alarms. High expiratory volumes can indicate patient distress, agitation, and high demand for air.
If there is difficulty in bagging the patient through the endotracheal tube, it will be important to perform inline suction through the endotracheal tube. Check patient positioning as well, as a patient who is flexed or with a bent neck can introduce kinking in the tubing. Mucus plugging is a common cause of airway obstruction, either in the endotracheal tube or in the larger airways.
Check the ventilator tubing for water or condensation that can collect, as this may trigger airway pressure or obstruction alarms. Low pulse oxygenation can be a symptom of a variety of problems with the ventilator or the patient. Problems with the oxygen source should be considered, such as an oxygen tank or bottle that has run out, or a problem with the central oxygen supply.
Low pulse oxygenation can as well indicate the presence of a pneumothorax, or perhaps mucus plugging, or maybe just inappropriate ventilator settings.
Low oxygen levels can as well reflect an overall worsening in the patient condition, such as perhaps the development of ventilator-associated pneumonia, a pleural effusion, or myocardial ischemia. It's important to assess hypoxia in the setting of other vital signs, as well as an assessment of the entire ventilator circuit. Agitation is a frequent problem with vented patients. In some cases, agitation is a part of the problem, such as in the case of central nervous system injury, intoxication, or metabolic derangement. Even just the presence of an endotracheal tube can be a source of discomfort for many patients, causing agitation. However, agitation can also signal a problem with the ventilator settings. The evaluation of agitation in vented patients is complex, and an in-depth assessment of the patient and ventilator system and settings should be undertaken before simply sedating or paralyzing the patient.
You're going to want to double-check all ventilator settings to make sure that the patients are receiving an adequate respiratory rate and an adequate respiratory tidal volume, and that there's adequate time as well for expiration. Address any ventilator alarms or problems in pressure or volume readings. Assess the patient for any sources of pain or discomfort. If possible, assess if perhaps different ventilator settings might help to improve the patient agitation.
If no cause for patient agitation can be found, then increasing or improving sedation or pain control should be considered. Most patients who are on a vent should be receiving some sedation, but in the setting of agitation, this may need to be increased. Pain control is critical, particularly if the patient has injuries or other sources of pain. In extreme cases where significant doses of multiple different sedatives have been tried and the patient agitation persists, paralysis may be considered. Paralytics should never be used without accompanying sedatives. A patient who is on a ventilator who experiences shock or declining blood pressure, perhaps with tachycardia, should have an immediate assessment of their cardiopulmonary status. What are some of the possibilities here, Dr. Joe?
Well, as patients on a ventilator are receiving positive pressure ventilation, there's always going to be the risk of a pneumothorax and then the development of a tension pneumothorax causing shock. As can be seen in the animation here, when lung airway pressure gets high, this can cause trauma to the lung, and indeed a lung can burst or pop, allowing air to escape out of the lung into the pleural space. As that pressure in the pleural space increases with each breath, given that there's positive pressure, the increasing pressure can occlude the return of venous blood to the right side of the heart, producing shock.
So how might a clinician detect this?
Well, For any patient on a ventilator, it's always going to be very important to be on the lookout for pneumothorax and to be considering this in any time your patient has vital sign instability. Of course, you're going to want to initially examine the chest and look for bilateral chest rise with each breath, as well as bilateral breast sounds. And this is going to be a crucial part. The physical examination is always very important. However, if there's still concern, a stat chest x-ray can be obtained to look and see if one lung has collapsed. Or you can also perform bedside ultrasound, which looking for lung sliding, and this can tell you if there's a pneumothorax as well. However, pneumothorax is not the only way positive pressure ventilation can cause shock. Don't forget that most patients on a ventilator are receiving at least some PEEP. Now, PEEP stands for positive end expiratory pressure. In asthmatics and patients with ARDS or acute respiratory distress syndrome, the amount of PEEP can get quite high.
That's true. This can cause a significant amount of intrathoracic pressure, which can impede the return of venous blood via the superior and inferior vena cava, the right side of the heart, causing shock.
This can be particularly true in asthmatics with an obstructive respiratory pattern who have impaired exhalation. It's always important to make sure that asthmatic patients have adequate time to exhale, and they may require more than the typical 1:2 I to E or inhalation to exhalation ratio that is typically set for patients on a ventilator who have normal lungs. When patients don't get a chance to fully exhale, we call this breath stacking, and it results eventually in excessive PEEP or what we call auto PEEP.
So what can we do in these cases then?
Well, auto PEEP can be checked in a variety of ways, including what we call an end expiratory hold in which the PEEP is measured directly after exhalation. If the PEEP measured is higher than the PEEP that is set on the ventilator, then you know that there's likely some auto PEEP and some excessive PEEP in addition to what you have set. Significant PEEP can also be seen on a chest x-ray, and this is usually seen as very large distended lungs. There are also ways to interpret PEEP on the pressure volume waveforms, but we'll avoid these for the purposes of this discussion.
In these situations, it can be necessary to remove the patient from the ventilator and just let the endotracheal tube open to air, allowing the pressure in the lungs to release. Afterwards, the patient can be reconnected to the ventilator with the appropriate PEEP and I to E ratio settings.
So there are two critical pressure variables that can be obtained on many ventilators. One of them is the peak inspiratory pressure, or PIP, and the other one is the plateau pressure, otherwise known as PPLAT. The PIP is the maximal pressure obtained on inspiration. The PPLAT is the pressure in the lungs and the system after an inspiration.
Evaluation of pressure volume waveforms for vented patients can yield a lot of information, but some vents do not provide waveform analysis, and some just provide numerical feedback of these values. Knowing what abnormalities in the PPLAT and PIP mean can be important for interpreting problems with patients and the vents or the circuit.
So for instance, if a patient has a high PIP, but a normal PPLAT, this can indicate there's a problem of resistance. So for instance, someone like an asthmatic with bronchospasm, perhaps an obstruction in the tube or a buildup of secretions.
If a patient has a high PIP or high PPLAT, it could indicate problems of lung compliance, patient positioning, patient body habitus, auto PEEP, or actually a pneumothorax.
And then lastly, if the PIP is low, this indicates there's likely a leak somewhere in the system. This could be a hole in the ventilator tubing, or maybe a hole or a laceration to the endotracheal tube, or maybe in a deflated endotracheal tube balloon. Patients who are vented for anything more than a few hours will require attention to hygiene. Endotracheal tubes can, over the course of hours and days, erode through lips and cause sores to the tongue and oropharynx, which can result in dangerous infections.
As well, attention to oral hygiene will be important to avoid the development of oral ulceration as well as oral infections. Patients on vents should have an oral care routine, including every 4 to 6 hour chlorhexidine mouthwash and toothbrushing. In the absence of chlorhexidine, another oral antiseptic solution or sterile water may be used.
And of course, patients should not be left with an endotracheal tube in place for more than 2 weeks. Different hospitals have different protocols, but in general, the longer an endotracheal tube is in place, the more likely patients are to have complications. So we have come to the end of the discussion. Some take-home points to consider and to make sure that we emphasize are, Number one, be systematic in your assessment. When you're concerned about a patient or when something happens like a ventilator alarm, check the patient, focus on the cardiopulmonary examination, and look for signs of pneumothorax or excessive PEEP. Check the vent starting from the wall with the power source and the oxygen supply, and follow these sources to the machine and then follow the ventilator tubing to the patient. Make sure the power is actually on. Make sure that oxygen is actually flowing and that the tank or the bottle is not empty. Check the vent and the ventilator tubing. If no problem is easily identified, remove the patient from the vent and bag with 100% oxygen.
And do remember the DOPS and DOTS checklists for identifying vent problems and common alarms. Suction if necessary, and consider causes of agitation, shock, or hypoxia in the vented patient.
All right. Well, thank you very much for joining us. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.